There we go. We are live. Hey, welcome to the Leadership Happy Hour Talk Show. I'm your host, Victor Vogel. Unfortunately, this is not going to be a talk show tonight, primarily because I cannot get my programs to work very well with me tonight. Both the OBS program as well as the YouTube live program just is not working well at all. So, anyway, welcome. I'm going to go ahead and do this video because I think it's important enough to put out there and rebroadcast, and I will put it on the YouTube channel. So you can go back there and I'll talk you through some of this issue. I was hoping to get some feedback on this. I've yet to figure out what in the world causes so many different dynamics from the last time I did the show till this week when I'm doing this show. Things change and I have no idea what causes those changes. But anyway, our topic today, it's not an easy topic. It's a difficult topic. It's about ethics and morality and leadership. And the problem is people tend to use these terms interchangeably. And they are really different all the way back for thousands of years that ethics and morals have been in play. People tend to use them interchangeably, and they tend to put different connotations on them than what really might be the meaning. So what's really important for you is simply to be able to attach a meaning to these two issues, ethics and morality, understand them well enough to be able to define the kinds of behaviors that you need to demonstrate in order to have these in your leadership style. The one thing that is absolutely important and definite is ethics and morals need to be in your leadership style. If you avoid either one of these two things, or you can misuse them like everything else, like the power bases we talked about last week, you know, you can use them correctly or you can use them incorrectly. This is pretty much true here. You can use ethics and morality correctly, or you can misuse it to deceive and corrupt. And we see that in different, you know, approaches to leadership. If you were the leader of a mafia family, then you would be using the morality and the ethics of these a little differently than if you happen to be the head of a CEO of a corporation. So let's try to put some meat on the bones in terms of what these topic areas really mean, and then we can talk a little bit about the behaviors. You can also, when I'm done with this and I post it on YouTube, you feel free to go in there and put any comments relative to behaviors that you've seen or not seen or misused about ethics and morality and leaders that you've known. That's what I'm trying to get to. Somehow I've got to figure out how to make the YouTube, I've tried Facebook and YouTube, and make those experiences smoother is a very difficult situation for some reason. So I've got to figure that out, and you know, it's a learning experience, and it's a free environment, and I'm learning as I go. So here we go. Let's start with morals. Let me just kind of go through where morals come from. Morals, well, both morals and ethics will come from a set of core values that you evolve as you grow up and over time. And values are, and we'll get in values and cultures next week, but values, you know, you have a set of what's called core values, and you don't have very many of those core values. And those core values will drive a lot of how you think and behave. So you'll see how that relates to ethics in a minute. But it certainly relates to your morals. Now, I think you need to think of morals. Most people, when they think of morals, they think about religion. And there are some really good dynamics associated with morals in the Bible and religion. There's no question about it. It's probably, the Bible probably has the single best set of morals to operate by than anything else out there. They've been in existence for well over 2,000 years, and people are still teaching and preaching and trying to get people to practice these particular behaviors, like, you know, love your neighbor like you love yourself, and don't commit adultery on your wife. And these are basic morals that come from the feeling that you have respect and concern for others. Okay, so think of morals that way. Morals, the influences, let's take a look at where influencers come from relative to morals. With morals, a lot of the morals that you will evolve and use later in life, and they don't change. I mean, it's not they can't change, but they are very, very hard to change core values and morals in people. They come from people like your parents. That's probably the first place you'll begin to establish your morals. They teach you how to treat other people, how to behave in front of other people, what to deal with relative to other people, and how to think about how you're going to behave generally. Okay, teachers, but from there's where you probably get the vast majority of biases. You might get a religious point of view. You might believe in God. You may not believe in God. You may be partly believe in God, but you don't believe in churches. All of these kinds of value systems come from the pastor and normally the church environment that you grow up in. Your teachers can give you worldviews or points of views that can turn into core values. If you have teachers that are very biased, or along with, you know, or if your parents happen to teach you a bias that, you know, anybody other than a person who is white is substandard to you, then that would be a problem with your teachers and your parents. And you're probably not going to get that in a religious environment, although you might nowadays with all the changes in the evangelical process that's going on. And then, of course, your friends can provide you certain set of morals relative to inclusiveness, you know, to make you feel wanted or not wanted or whatever. And I find it interesting because there was recently a fellow who ran over a bunch of people in Canada. And one of the things that's come out is this person believes very strongly that if you're attractive but you cannot get a female to pay attention to you or like you or be consistent about liking you, that there is a problem with that. And they have a whole group of people who have this issue, and it is a truly bigoted, biased issue towards women. Not even considering there may be something other than appearance that would attract a woman to a man. So that's a situation where people around you, your associates, friends, etc., can in some ways impact your morals and create a particular perspective in your mind about how things should be, how life should be, how you should live your life. What we know about morals is that they're very personal. these, a lot of times you talk to different people, they have a different set of morals or standards they live by. We do know that as you, morals and core values are ingrained in people over time, and they become very hard, if not impossible, to change in people. So love, hate, bigotry, racism, being a helper or giving, these are kinds of both positive and negative morals that are evolved, and they normally will be very hard to change. You're also more passionate about these. If somebody is challenging a particular core value or moral that you have, you become very defensive or angry, like it's not supposed to be that way. It's supposed to be the way that I believe it should be. And of course, with morals, because they are so personal and there are so many perspectives on morals, you know, if you have this passionate attitude that you don't feel you need to change, and it's really about you, then that can ingrain a person and make it very difficult for them to survive in an environment outside of people who are not like them or do not have the same morals. So but morals, if you think about it, are probably the way to put it. They're how you feel, and they have to do with good and evil, whether something is good or something is bad or evil. So that's a good way to think about morals. Now let's talk a little bit about what come off of the morals, and let's talk a little bit about ethics. And ethics, you're going to see how they can get confused and why people tend to use them interchangeably, but there is a difference that if you keep this in mind will help you to use both of these issues as a leader, to be more effective as a leader. So let's look at ethics. The things that influence ethics, they're more like rules. So the things that tend to influence ethics are governments and the law. You know, the rule of law, people say it is the backbone, it's one of the backbones of our democracy, is the rule of law. Without that, being able to have the law to go by, it would be very chaotic, and it would be an impossible world to live in. Influencers are organizations, you know, and normally what you find here are policies or procedures that organizations have established that fit their particular norms for what they feel should or shouldn't be. And we often see people who become somewhat confused or disrupted when they move in, say, one organization that has a set of policies and operates a certain way, and then they are either bought or transfer or rehired into another organization that have policies and ethics and rules and procedures that are much different than where they were before. And we've seen this, I think, you know, when you look at General Kelly, who was in the military, and they have the military is very set, historically, sound set of policy rules and regulations that everybody has lived by for hundreds of years in the military. When you move out of that, you try to move in where command and control, for example, is an ethic. You know, you are required to follow the orders of your superior, your leader, your commander. So if you move out of that environment into an environment like the chief of staff, where everything is not done by a command and control environment, not done by having a clear set of guidelines and rules that say this is right and this is wrong, where things change and may alter quite a bit, then you see there where you could have some real issues about the difference between the ethics of the military and the ethics of politics in the White House and the executive office or the executive branch of government, or Congress for that matter. So organizations, you can be influencers about what ethics are used. Societies can set norms and have sort of rules and policies. You know, it's not okay to just go out and kill somebody you don't like. We did have that sort of in the Wild West early on in our history, but as laws began to set in, because people live in fear constantly, and if you were the weaker individual in society and you didn't have a gun, for example, you may not make it through versus someone that did. But society has norms, and then you can set that out and go into a more global perspective on that and understand that if you're doing business in the United States, we have a certain set of norms and regulations we do business by. When you take that globally into other countries, you have to take into account their norms and values when you're interacting with them, particularly if you're trying to influence them in a leadership role. One of the big problems we have with our president right now is he does not see past the United States. In fact, he is totally focused on the United States, but we don't live isolated. We live in a world of other people. Whether we like it or not, whether we think we can isolate or not, we really can. So societies set norms and values and rules also. And then you have things like clubs, various clubs and organizations that have their traditions, and that's a good way to think of ethics. Rules and policies and procedures that become tradition, and they become, you know, you're expected to honor those traditions and approaches when you're in that particular club or that particular society. And if you don't want to, then you can certainly get kicked out. And then when you try to change those, like racism or lifestyle changes in America, you see the conflict that can arise because the ethics associated with how you treat others and how you make things happen becomes to change. So ethics are more focused on like norms and policies and rules and procedures, and they're more likely to change. Ethics are more open to changing than core values and morals of people. Now, what do they have in common? Well, what they both have in common is they have the idea that people are impacted by both of them. They're both focused on people. When you think about the ethics, you're really thinking about the right and wrongness of something. When you're thinking about morals, you're trying to decide whether it's good or bad. Now, right and wrong, good or bad, you know, how do you kind of differentiate it? Well, what makes sense to me and what I've seen when I talk to leaders about how to use these topics to be more effective is you begin with the good and the evil, okay? Because that is the basic thing that will get people more mad, more frustrated, more dug in than ethics will. Because ethics, because they are less focused on just core values, they are more susceptible and open to being able to be flexible to change. A like you may have a policy that you work from 8 to 5. That's, you know, and the ethics of that policy, the ethics would apply in that policy, in that the expectation is you will work from 8 to 5 with whatever time off you have in between. You're delivering a day's work for an honest day's work for an honest wage. Okay. So now we can debate a lot of things like honest wage or, you know, what's work week and things like that. But that's a general principle. There's a set of norms and people hold you accountable to those norms. Now, if those norms violate your particular morals, for example, if you happen to be sick, in the early 1900s, before unions came about, and there was child labor, I mean, if you were sick, you may not have a job if you didn't come to work sick. And so, morally speaking, you're really abusing a person when you require them to get out of bed, come to work at the risk of making their health worse. Okay, so you know, so the ethics might be, say, in the early 1900s was, hey, you know, you're supposed to be here. If you can't be here and work, I'll replace you with somebody who can. And that's the rules, those are the policies, that's the how we as a company operate. Those are the ethics that we live by in our company. Now, that's pretty stringent. You don't see that much today, but it's a good example because it's an extreme example, and normally extreme examples point things out better. But you may look at that morally and say, you know, you don't care about me at all. I am just another tool you have in your shop to get your work done so you can sell it and market it. Now, without me, do you have the potential to do that? And back in the early 1900s, they did not. Okay, hence the unions sprung up going, hey, look, you can't treat people that way. It's not a good thing to do. It's a bad thing to do. And if you're going to do something bad, we're going to fight back and we're going to strike and you're not going to be able to get your product out. And the companies then, of course, rebelled saying, you know, that's against the rules and it's safe. But you can see how now we pit good and evil against right and wrong. And consequently, you can get a lot of conflict going in there that's extremely bad. So how does this relate to leaders in general? Well, first of all, people, as a leader, your job, I think we talked about this last week, your primary role, the product of being a leader, is influencing other people's behavior and changing that behavior in the direction you want them to go. So now you can do that coercively, like we said, or you can do it through expert referent power bases, those likability and being expert and building trust and those kinds of things. So you can see that if your mentality is such that you have no sense of good about you when you think about the people who work for you, that they are nothing more than a tool. They can be disposed of readily without any problem. You don't need them. They don't mean anything to you. They don't have any value to what you do. That would be a moral judgment you have about the people who work for you. And since they don't come to work and do the job when they're sick, or they want some time off to enjoy themselves, like vacations and stuff, then you, if they're not there every minute of the day, and that's your expectation, those are the ethics that are associated with your company, then my guess is today in the United States, you would have a difficult time as a leader getting your job done and getting your product out to your customer. Now, if you live in Africa, or you live in the Mid East, or you live in Indonesia, or somewhere in Asia, or Russia, or places like that, China, China is, you talk about an interesting thing about how morality and ethics work. You tell me how you feel people see the Chinese government when they put a social measurement on you. They have just instituted a social measurement. So they have decided the right and wrong things and the standard of those right and wrong things. And they have put a measurement. And if you do not measure up to those standards, they punish you. They use that coercive leadership style. They punish you by doing things like not allowing you to have a passport to travel out of the country, not allowing you to travel on trains or airplanes or not have a car. This is their process for dealing with people who do not meet their standards, their ethics, if you will, in China. Now, is that good or evil? What is their primary purpose? Is it the betterment of me, the person, the individual? Is that why those rules are made? Are they telling me that if they get these behavior standards hit, my life as a person in China will be so much better, that everything, you're doing this for me. You're doing this to make my life better in China. So as leadership in China, we're instituting these ethics, if you will, about how you should live your life. And we are telling you that that is going to be in your best interest, but unfortunately, you're assuming everybody in China has the same moral structure. And they don't. They don't. And so consequently, they will have resistance, and it'll be underground resistance to this kind of a program down the road. So they will have to put the hammer down. They will have to arrest people and throw them in jail and persecute them. All the things that we over here don't experience. It's hard for you to imagine how you would live under that society that says, hey, look, you can't do this. You can't do this. And by the way, I'm going to put a number. I'm going to rate you. And in your rating structure, you turn out not to be what I expected to be, then you don't get to have a car, or you don't get to travel anywhere, or you don't get to go on vacation, or I don't know. The worst case scenario is we're going to arrest you and put you in jail. So leaders really, if you think about that, if your product is to influence people to change your behavior, to work better for you, to get your product out there, then a leader needs to understand, here's how you can use morals to interface with ethics to get you where you want to be. First of all, you have to understand the individuals who are working for you. You can't do that if you just sit in your office all day long. You have to get down. You have to get out of your office. You have to make connection with your people. You have to build relationships to understand where they're coming from. What are their values? What do they value? What are their morals? What's important to them? Why is it important? And then compare that to what the company or the organization that you're working for or leading is trying to establish as the rules and guidelines to operate by. Okay, so when you institute a program like the Chinese Institute, then somebody has to be looking over your shoulder every minute. If your value, if your morals are such that you feel you should have the freedom not to have somebody looking over your shoulder all the time, to live your life peacefully, and particularly after hours, then, you know, you have conflict, and your people are not going to be satisfied. They're not going to look at you. They're not going to be as a good leader. They're not going to be inspired to do what you want them to do. They may grudgingly do it, but they are going to be working on how to get out of that scenario or how to resist that scenario from that point on, because it violates those personal moral values that a person has, and it violates them to the point where they'll do whatever it takes to make this happen. Some of this can go to the extreme. It can drive somebody to the point where they do a workplace violence scenarios, and those are evil things. And the problem is there's such a conflict between the core values of what they feel are right and the ethics or rules that are applied to them. When you have, as a leader, if you have that kind of a large gap between morals and ethics, and you can't recognize it, and you don't see it, and you don't rectify that issue, then you have a very, very difficult situation on your hands, all the way from, you know, not getting the product you want, to sabotaging the product you want, to outright violence in the end, is where we've seen that. So, you know, where does this all begin? It begins with you as a leader. You have to sit back and ask yourself, what's important to me? Who am I? Where are my morals? Where are my sense of good and evil? And where does that stand relative to the company I'm working in, the people I'm around? You got to do this for family. You got to do it for people you associate with and friends. And you have to also do it as a leader in business. It's the same thing. And then you have to ask yourself, you know, what are the ethics that I'm being asked to apply? And do they make sense? Are they ethics? Are they just? Are they fair? Are they good? Are they bad kinds of things that we're asking people to do? Okay, so if for example, if you happen to be a leader and you have people out there representing you, and you lie about something and you ask them to lie also and support you, you know, does that eat at the core moral values of that individual to the point where they're saying, you know, I can't do this, I can't lie for you? Or are they at a point where they're going, you know, I've got to really balance off whether I have a job or not, because I need this job, so I'm going to have to lie? And it really gets to be a deep problem. If you're a quality leader, you're going to recognize those issues and you're going to do something about them. So there's just, you know, you can Google ethics and morals and get into this deeply if you want, but it really comes down to, who are you? Are you a good person, or do you operate as an evil person? And do you apply ethics and standards that are good for not only the company, but for the people that are working with the company? Because in the end, unless you work for a dictator like China or some of these other countries, unless you have that dictatorship role, you have to influence people. You can't demand or command they do it. You have a certain amount of control over them, but eventually that control doesn't mean anything if they have to give up their deep-seated core values. Okay, so they will leave you. As much as they need that job, they will leave you, and they will leave you flat-footed, and sometimes they'll get mad when they leave you and take things with them, like trade secrets, or they'll sabotage a manufacturing line as they're going off the line. I mean, all kinds of things happen like this on a regular basis. Or in a government like ours, a democracy, where some of these morals are protected, like racism. You can't be racist in America. That's an ethic. You cannot be racist. And if you are racist and you behave that way, you will have to suffer the consequences of the law. And that's where you see a lot of these companies, and there's where the Me Too movement blossomed out, and out of that comes the equal pay movement for women and a whole host of other things that people are now surfacing that are core values, morals in their life that intersect with the rules and regulations of ethics and companies, and that's where the conflict arises. You can eliminate that conflict if you understand where you're coming from and you operate in a way that respects the morals and values of other people. You can only do that if you take the time to get to know your people. You cannot be an absentee leader. You cannot be a leader who does not get down amongst the people and understand what's going on. All great leaders have done that. They walk amongst their people. They get to know them. They build a relationship, a trusting relationship. That's what gets the work done. Okay, I hope you found this interesting. I'm sorry it didn't come across on YouTube as an interactive process, but I'll keep working on that. I don't know that I'll ever get it there, to be honest with you, given the net neutrality and a bunch of other stuff that are going on. So I hope you find this topic area beneficial. It's a tough one to deal with, but if you can master it, you can be a great leader as opposed to an average leader or a poor leader. Okay. All right. This is Victor Vogel. Thank you for watching and listening to me on the Leadership Happy Hour Talk Show. I'm going to do these every Wednesday from 5:30 to 6:15 p.m. Unless it appears as though that might be a bad time to try to get bandwidth and that kind of stuff, in which case I might move this a little later to see if the ability to log on and get something broadcast over YouTube's a little easier later in the evening. So, in which case, we'll probably have to change it to the leadership later happy hour talk show. So, well, until then, I hope you enjoy it. I hope this has been helpful to you. If it has, please share it with some other folks. If you have questions, please put them in the comments, or, you know, I will try to get back to you and let folks know. If you need to if for some reason you need to reach me, you can say that, and then we can talk about how to get emails exchanged and things like that. So until then, drive safe, take your time, remember Uber and Lyft are out there, okay? Have a great day.